when they saw that result down at Carrow Road, Norwich beating City. How surprised were you?
Of course, surprised, because everyone knows City is a good team. Won the Prem last year, so I think everyone was surprised. But of course, I spoke to Tim Krul before the game and after the game, and I know how they want to play, and they keep playing. So I'm not surprised how they played and how they win the game, but it's more about surprise how City approached the game and lost that one.
Does it make you think that City are human after all? That they're not unbeatable.
It's football, isn't it? So that's the beauty of football. Everyone can win against each other, and then you have to believe in you can win every single game.
What about Norwich's situation now, coming to Burnley? Does that make you slightly more wary of them?
No, it's just like we know what they want to do, is know how they play. But I think the main thing is that we play how we want to play, and bring the game to them, and make sure at the end of the 90 minutes we get the 3 points.
I'm guessing the journey back home from Brighton would have been a lot longer if you hadn't got that late goal last Saturday.
Yeah,
what was the mood like on the way home?
A bit up and down, to be honest. Because I think we started the game really well, but we didn't score. Then Brighton, they changed the system how they play, and we got a bit more in trouble. Second half, it's not us, to all fairness. We are much better than that. So nick a goal in the last minute is makes you happy, of course, but makes you realise that has to be better as well the second half.
A win this weekend could possibly take Burnley into the top 10. Is that where you should be aiming this season?
Yeah, I think so. If you look at the group and the players that we have a good group, good quality. So we must aim as high as possible. Of course, like I said before, it's a difficult league to play in. But that's the beauty again.
Have you got to win your home games? Is the pressure on you, even at this stage in the season, to win the home games?
I prefer to win every single game, but it's always nice to win the home games and then get a bit of the pressure out of the away games. But you can tell every single game it starts 0-0, so I think every single game you have to try take the max out of it, what we did at Brighton, even though we didn't play a good second half.
The manager mixed it up, bringing his subs on. There's been a lot of suggestion this week that maybe he might mix it up again and change his team. What are the thoughts within the squad? You're seeing the same 11 start more or less week in, week out. Are the players on the fringes desperate to get a game now?
I think everyone wants to play. No one wants to sit on the bench, including me. But I think the gaffer is aiming, of course, that the subs are ready to come in and change the game for us. That was what happened against Brighton. So I think a lot of people are knocking on the door to show the gaffer, listen, I need to play. And it is on us, the first 11, to show, listen, the gaffer, I'm the first choice, I need to play. So it's good that you have this kind of group. The competition is really high for every single position. So it's good that triggers you to get the best out of yourself.
Thank you. Have you talked about how to deal with Timo Pukki out on the training pitches? Is he someone that you maybe need to or...
No, you have to be aware of all Norwich, not only Pukki, of course, because not Pukki can't do it by himself, isn't it? But no, of course, we prepared for Pukki, and tomorrow we have another session to go, and we go in a bit more detail. But yeah, now as a defender, you talk with defenders and see what's best to do.
And I know you mentioned talking to Tim at the start of this one. Will there be any conversation before the match this week,
100%.
Or is it radio?
I'm going to call him late in the car. 100% I'm going to call him.
You are going to.
100%. I'm going to make him ready.
Is this mind games now? You're going
to I'm going to imagine my goal against him, against Newcastle. So I'm going to make him ready.
But on a serious note, you are really good friends, aren't you?
No, we're really close. We met each other when we were 17, World Cup in Peru. Ever since, we kept contact and stayed close. Yeah.
Good man. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. No, really good. I'm really happy. I'm really pleased to be here. The group is just perfect for me. A really good group of lads. Makes me feel at home. And the only thing what I need to do now is show that I belong here. So I'm really happy.
Yeah, and is it kind of what you expected?
Yeah, I spoke to a couple of friends before. And of course, Bardo was here, so I know him. A coach was here as well before. So I spoke to them and the choice was quite easy to go and to come here and sign.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, like I said in previous interviews, I don't sign at a club that I'm happy to sit on the bench. I want to play as like every other single player. So I know the competition was tough to go 1v1 against Charlie, but I know he's a quality left back. He still is, absolutely. So I have to be in my top level every single time, week in, week out, to make sure that I play.
Hi, Eric. You mentioned then you go way back with Tim. Is that from international duty? Is that where you first?
Yeah, international duty. Else? Yeah. Like I said, we played the World Cup together in Peru. Then became European champion together on the 21s in Holland. So even like the first team, a couple of times we've been together. So we go way back.
How often do you come across? So obviously you come across ex-teammates, players you've played with, players you've played against all the time. But in terms of coming across someone who you would consider an actual sort of close friend, how often and unusual is that in football?
Not much, to be honest. I came across him last year when I played Stoke Norwich, of course, and Championship. In the Premier League, came across a couple of times, so I don't think it happened that often, especially not the relationship that we have together, because in the good and bad times we were there for each other and talked through what was best to do, and I'm really pleased with him that he's now the first choice there and he's back in the Prem as well.
And just lastly for me, you're playing sort of behind Dwight McNeil. He's obviously a relative newcomer to the first team level. Just how have you found that sort of relationship with him? Have you been able to advise him and give him a little bit of sort of experience and know-how and that sort of stuff?
He is young and he's new, but like that's a good thing. He's kind of free in how he plays. Of course, here and there he needs a bit more adjustments, but that's me for. Like I'm playing behind him, so I can control him, I can talk to him and think what is best. But to all fairness, young players, you need to keep them going. Just let them play free, because I think that way is they get the best out of themselves. And I think Dwight is a really good player. Of course, as a young player, you always have to improve yourself, including him. But if you just keep playing free and of course, in the system that we play, he has a bright future.
And keep helping you out as well defensively.
Hopefully.
What's expectation? From the player's point of view, I know the manager has expectations and the fans have expectations. What do you expect from yourselves? Where you should be finishing the league? What's success?
No, I think looking at the table, of course, a bit early, but I think every single game that we play, we could get something out of the games. Even though that we lost Liverpool 3-0, like been a kind of lucky first goal, missed pass the second goal. So if those things we get out of our system, out of our play, that the game is still on. So looking at the team that we have, looking at the players that we have, I think we have to aim as high as possible. And for sure, maybe around 10 positions is more than possible.